Want to learn your target language for free? Then get our language gifts of the month right now, before they expire. Here's what you're getting this month. First, the Giving Directions Conversation Cheat Sheet. Do you know how to tell a taxi driver where to go in your target language? You'll be able to. With this PDF cheat sheet, you'll learn must-know words and phrases for giving directions. Second, the Most Common Verbs PDF eBook. You'll learn over 90 common verbs with this bonus PDF picture eBook. Download and review on any device. Third, how to talk about what you do in your free time. Learn how to say video games, fishing, and much more. You'll pick up over 25 words for leisure activities with this vocab bonus. Fourth, how to learn from home, learning strategies. Want to learn the language from the comfort of your own home? This 1-minute lesson will give you all the best tactics for learning languages. Fifth, the top 35 adjectives for personalities. Can you describe your personality? This next bonus will teach you the 35 must-know adjectives for personalities, so you can talk about yourself in your target language. Sixth, free language learning audiobooks. Want free access to our huge library of beginner-level audiobooks? Then click the link below. Save the audiobooks to your device and listen and learn. They're yours to keep forever. And finally, the deal of the month. If you want to finally master the language with lessons by real teachers and our complete language learning program, get up to 45% off our 6-month challenge sale. To get your gifts and language learning resources, click the link in the description below. Download them right now before they expire.
Hi everyone, welcome back to ItalianPod101.com. My name is Daisy. Mi chiamo Daisy, mi chiamo Daisy, and in this video we're going to talk about how to start a conversation. Come iniziare una conversazione. Come iniziare, how to start, una conversazione, a conversation. Basically, conversation starters. And as in English, we also say to break the ice, and that's rompere il ghiaccio. Rompere, to break, il ghiaccio, the ice. To break the ice, we can say, the basic one is, hi, how are you? Ciao, come stai? Ciao, come va? How is it going? Come stai? Come va? Now, this is tricky because it can end badly, meaning, bene tu? I'm fine, and you? Yeah, me too. And that's it? Bene tu? Anche io. But no, we want to keep going, right? So what you have to say is bene, oggi ho fatto, I'm fine, today I did, oggi ho fatto, and then you say what happened. Oggi ho fatto sport con gli amici. Today I played sports with my friends. And then the other part can say, oh really, che sport? Quale sport? Which sport do you play? Right? Another thing that you can ask, in general, is cosa mi racconti? Cosa mi racconti? And this is a pretty open question, so it can be anything from the other part. You're not asking anything specific, they're free to tell you what they want. Here too, if they say niente di che, not much, nothing really, niente di che, or nulla di nuovo, nothing new, no news, then it's up to you to keep the conversation going and tell something about what you did or what happened to you. But let's see some phrases that you can use in different scenarios. For example, let's assume you're at a party and you want to talk to someone. You can start by saying, ti piace questa canzone? Do you like this song? Ti piace questa canzone? Or in general, ti piace questa musica? Do you like this music? And then, depending if it's yes or no, you can pretend that that's also your opinion and just keep going, right? So, for example, if the other one says no, then you can ask quale genere ti piace? Which genre do you like? Which kind of music do you like? Quale genere di musica ti piace? O cosa ascolti di solito? What do you usually listen to? Cosa ascolti, to listen, di solito, usually, solitamente, it's another way to say di solito, solitamente. Cosa ascolti solitamente? Moving on, let's assume you're at a bar, a pub, or anyway, you're somewhere where you can drink something, and even better, maybe the other one is drinking something already. You can ask, cosa stai bevendo? What are you drinking? Cosa stai bevendo? Be careful, because if you ask, cosa bevi? What do you drink? Cosa bevi? That can be, if they have the glass in their hand already, that can be, what are you drinking? But also, what are you gonna drink? Cosa bevi? What can I get you, basically? So I would say, cosa stai bevendo? What are you drinking? Also, because cosa bevi could be a bit in general, like what do you drink usually? What can you drink? So yeah, cosa stai bevendo? Or cosa mi consigli? What do you recommend me? Maybe you're in line waiting for your turn to order a drink. So you can ask, cosa mi consigli? What do you recommend me? Cosa, what, mi, to me, consigli, recommend. And then if you want to be the one who recommends something instead, you can say, io ti consiglio, I recommend you, io ti consiglio questo cocktail, this cocktail. And then you say the name, Malibu Cola for me. If, for example, you're at the gym, you can ask, fai altri sport? Do you play other sports? Fai, we use the verb to do. Fare, fai altri sport, fai altri sport, do you play other sports? Or, quante volte a settimana ti alleni? How often, how many times in a week do you train? Quante volte a settimana, how many times in a week, a settimana, ti alleni? Do you train? Possiamo allenarci insieme? Can we train together? Possiamo allenarci insieme, together? In case the person you're talking to or that you're gonna talk to is a common friend, then maybe you can ask, how do they know your friend? Come conosci Luca? Come, how, conosci, do you know, Luca? Come conosci Luca? And likewise, you can ask other things as well, right? For example, how do you know about this party? Come conosci questo evento? How do you know about this event? Come conosci questa festa? Come conosci questo evento? Come conosci, how do you know? And then it can be a person or a thing, or a language even. Come conosci l'inglese? How do you know English? If we're talking about someone of the neighborhood, del vicinato, then, for example, you're in the elevator or something, you can ask, conosci, again, do you know, un buon ristorante, a good restaurant? Conosci un buon ristorante qua vicino? Do you know a nice restaurant here nearby? Or, conosci un buon supermercato? Let's assume you just moved to the neighborhood. Conosci un buon supermercato? Do you know a nice supermarket? Buon in this case can also mean convenient, as in cheap. So buon always saves you. You just have to decide what to ask for. Conosci una buona palestra? Do you know a nice gym? If it's someone that you know from your office or that you work with together, maybe you can ask, che programmi hai per il weekend? What are your programs for the weekend? Che programmi, what programs, I, do you have, per il weekend, for the weekend? Cosa fai nel weekend? What are you doing during the weekend? Cosa fai nel weekend? No matter the situation or the place, something that always helps can be a compliment. So pick something out from the outfit of the person that you want to talk to and say, che bella maglia, che belle scarpe, che bei pantaloni. You can choose, right? Che bella maglia, what a nice shirt. Che belle scarpe, nice shoes. Che bei pantaloni, trousers. Che bella borsa, what a nice bag. Dove l'hai comprata? Dove, where, l'hai comprata? Did you buy it? Where did you buy it? Dove l'hai comprata? And from there, you can go on. But of course, only if you really like something, right? Because you don't want to be completely fake. So maybe something else that you can ask, since recently everyone is on their phones, is about apps that you have been using recently. Hai qualche app divertente sul telefono? Do you have some interesting, funny, divertente or interessante sul telefono? Do you have some interesting, funny apps on the phone? Hai qualche app interessante sul telefono? Or che app usi di più ultimamente? Che app usi di più ultimamente? Which app, application, are you using more recently? Quale app usi di più, more, the most, recently, recentemente, or ultimamente, lately? Che app usi di più, recentemente? And that could be a really long conversation if the other person is into technology, for example. And this is about situations that can happen anytime. But my personal tip is to focus on the season and on celebrations that are coming. For example, if it's summer, dove sei stato quest'estate? Where have you been this summer? Dove sei stato quest'estate? This summer. Quest'estate. It would be questa estate, but two vowels together. Dove sei stato quest'estate? It doesn't really mean, what have you been up to? I haven't seen you recently. It just asks if you went somewhere for the summer. So the other person could tell you about what they did, or non sono andato in vacanza. I didn't go on vacation, I didn't have a break. And then you can talk about why, what happened, how's the work going, etc. In autumn, do you like pumpkin? Ti piace la zucca? Ti piace, do you like la zucca? The pumpkin. Ti piace la zucca? For winter, hai già comprato i regali di Natale? Hai già comprato? Have you already bought i regali, presents, di Natale, for Christmas? Have you already bought Christmas presents? Hai già comprato i regali di Natale? And in spring, let's say, sei allergico al polline? Tu sei allergico al polline? Are you allergic to pollen? I hope these phrases can be helpful to attaccare un bottone with someone. Literally, it means to attach, to sew, to put a button to its place, right? Attaccare un bottone to someone con qualcuno. Attaccare un bottone con qualcuno. It's a way of saying, an idiomatic expression, that means to start talking to someone. To approach someone. So let me know in the comments which one is your best way to attaccare un bottone. And I'm not talking about sewing skills. So yeah, let me know if you have any particular phrase that you would like to know. I hope this video was useful. Thank you for watching. Remember to like and subscribe. And if you haven't done it yet, you can sign up for your free lifetime account on italianpod101.com in order to improve your Italian even more. I'll see you soon. Bye bye! Hello everyone, welcome back to italianpod101.com. My name is Daisy. Mi chiamo Daisy. Mi chiamo Daisy. And in this video we're gonna talk about demonstratives. Dimostrativi. Dimostrativi. Actually both adjectives and pronouns, so aggettivi e pronomi. Adjectives, aggettivi e pronomi, pronouns. Demonstratives, dimostrativi. As in English, they're used to indicate, to show something, depending on where the object is compared to the speaker, right? So for example, this, that. In Italian, you indicate something that is close to you with questo. Questo. Remember that as other adjectives as well, in Italian, questo changes depending on the name that follows. So questo is just male and singular. For example, questo libro è molto interessante. Questo libro, this book, is molto interessante. Very interesting. Questo libro. Libro is male and singular, and that's why questo stays like that. Questo libro. You see, it ends with the same vowel. If, for example, I'm talking about a skirt, which in Italian is female and singular, gonna, gonna, ho comprato questa gonna con i saldi. Ho comprato, I bought, questa gonna, this skirt, questa gonna, con i saldi, on sale. Puoi aiutarmi con questi esercizi? Sono troppo difficili. Puoi aiutarmi con questi esercizi? Sono troppo difficili. Puoi aiutarmi? Can you help me? Con questi esercizi? With these exercises? Plural, in Italian, plural and male. Questi, questi esercizi? Sono troppo difficili. They're too difficult. Sono troppo difficili. Mi piacciono molto queste scarpe. Mi piacciono molto queste scarpe. Queste scarpe. Plural and female, queste. Queste. I really like these shoes. Queste scarpe. So I'm talking about something that I have either really close to me, like to my person, or something really close in time. So for example, I can say questa settimana, this week, settimana is female and singular, questa settimana sono molto impegnata. I'm really busy. Sono molto impegnata. Questa settimana. So the one that is going on, the closest to me. It doesn't have to be something short, right? It can be something long as well. For example, quest'anno, this year, quest'anno, voglio andare al mare. I want to go to the sea. Quest'anno voglio andare al mare. So questo, to indicate something that is the closest to you, either in the space or in time. Questo, questa, questi, or queste. While if we are talking about something that is far from you, that it's not near you, then we use that, which in Italian translates into quello, quello, quello. Quello zaino è mio. That bag, that backpack, is mine. Quello zaino. In this case, as the article, it depends on the word that follows. So, quello or quel, quel, like with the determinative article, il or lo. Let's revise briefly. You use il, basically with any consonant, while lo with z or s plus any other consonant. Like lo scoglio, the cliff. So that would be quello scoglio. While il cane, quel cane, okay? While you don't have to worry when there is a vowel at the beginning of the word, because in that case it's just l apostrofo, and with quel the same. Quell'albero, that tree, quell'albero, quel apostrofi, albero. Of course, it also applies to the plural form. Quegli occhiali sono da sole. Quegli occhiali, those glasses are sunglasses. Quegli occhiali sono da sole. Quegli occhiali, because you would say gli occhiali if it was just an article. While quei gatti, because you would say i gatti if it was just the article, not gli gatti, okay? Quei gatti sono di mio zio. Those cats are my uncle's. Quei gatti. Not so much to think about when we're talking about a female noun, because there's only quella and quelle. Quella ragazza, that girl. Non conosco quella ragazza. I don't know that girl. Non conosco. I don't know quella ragazza, that girl. Ma sembra simpatica. But she looks funny. But she looks nice. Ma sembra simpatica. Guarda quelle case laggiù. Look, those houses over there. Sono molto belle. Guarda quelle case laggiù. Sono molto belle. They're really beautiful. Quelle case. Here too, as before, you can also use the same demonstrative adjective for time. For example, quell'anno, that year, quell'anno, sono, you see the apostrophe here, quell'anno, sono andato in vacanza a Londra. That year I went to London on holiday. Quell'anno sono andato in vacanza on holiday a Londra, to London. Of course, as I said in the beginning, you can use these words, queste parole, these words, as pronouns as well. So when they replace the name altogether. For example, questa penna non scrive, this pen doesn't work, doesn't write, questa penna non scrive, dammi quella, give me that, give me that, dammi quella. Of course I could say dammi quella penna if I wanted to, but I can just say dammi quella. And in that case, that word, quella, the demonstrative article, becomes a pronoun because it replaces the whole word, penna, the whole object, basically. Quel vestito non mi stava bene. Ecco perché ho preso questo. Quel vestito non mi stava bene. Ecco perché ho preso questo. That dress didn't suit me. Quel vestito, that dress, non mi stava bene. Didn't suit me. Ecco perché, that's why, ho preso questo. I got this one. That's why I got this one. Ecco perché ho preso questo. As shown in the examples, please notice that in Italian you don't have to translate one as in this one. Questo, I got this one instead, ho preso questo. You don't have to add anything after questo or quello, but if you really want to, and sometimes you can hear that as well, especially when we're talking, you can say questo qua, so this one here, questo qua, while quello laggiù, quello over there, or quello là, quello there. It's just a way to emphasize the fact that it's quello, that one, and not this one, okay? Questo qua, quello là. Quale macchina ti piace? Which car do you like? Quale macchina ti piace? Questa, this one, questa. And that's enough. Or you can say questa qua, this one over here, this one here. Usually we say that when we're comparing things. So for example, I would say questa qua è molto bella. This one here is really beautiful. Mentre quella là, while that one there, non mi piace. I don't like. I don't like the one over there. Questa qua and quella là. In that case, it's more common for us to use qua and là, but in general, you don't have to. You just need one word. We're lazy. The last thing that I want to teach you is that sometimes in some grammar books, you can find the word codesto, codesto, and that's also a demonstrative adjective or pronoun that was used really a long time ago, basically. And okay, sometimes in like written texts or like official texts as a lawyer or something, you can still find it, but we don't really use that anymore. Still, I just thought it may be better for you to know in case it pops up somewhere. And it refers to an object that is closer to the listener than to the speaker, okay? Since it doesn't really make sense to examine every time which one is closer, that's why we don't use it anymore. But I want you to know that it exists, okay? So let me know what you thought about questa lezione, about this lesson, questa lezione. Thank you for watching, and remember, if you haven't done it yet, you can sign up for your free lifetime account on italianpod101.com in order to learn Italian in the fastest, easiest, and most fun way possible. I see you soon! Bye bye! Ciao ciao! Hi everyone, welcome back to italianpod101.com. My name is Daisy, mi chiamo Daisy, mi chiamo Daisy, and in this video we're gonna talk about means of transport, mezzi di trasporto. Mezzi di trasporto. First of all, let's briefly revise some verbs that we use when we talk about transportation. For example, andare, to go, usare, to use, usare, viaggiare, to travel, and to take, prendere, to take, prendere. I wanted you to remember those, because every time that we talk about transportations, there are actually many ways to say that you're using something, that you're traveling with something, or that you're taking something, that you're going by something, as in English, in Italian as well. And those verbs that we just saw together are really common. So let's try to use all of them. For example, per andare in ufficio, to go to the office, per andare in ufficio, per andare, to go, to the office, in ufficio, prendo la metropolitana. Prendo, I take, la metropolitana, the subway. Metropolitana, subway. Sometimes, almost always actually, you will hear just metro. It comes from metropolitana, it's just a shorter way to say that, right? Per andare in ufficio, prendo la metropolitana. To go to the office, I take the subway. Or, I could say, vado in ufficio con la metropolitana. I go to the office by subway. Con la metropolitana. Or, per andare in ufficio, uso la metropolitana. Uso the subway. Okay? Of course, you could also say, per andare in ufficio, viaggio in metropolitana, I travel by subway, but viaggiare has more the idea of a longer journey, or that you're actually going somewhere to stay there a bit, as in days, hopefully, and you're not staying days at your office. So I would use viaggiare, when I'm actually talking about going somewhere. It would be a longer ride, for example, viaggio spesso in aereo. I often travel by plane. Viaggio spesso in aereo. Aereo, plane. You could also say con l'aereo or in aereo. Aereo, plane. Perché è molto veloce. Because it's really fast. Perché è molto veloce. Non mi piace viaggiare in treno. I don't like traveling by train. Non mi piace viaggiare in treno. Treno is train. Perché è noioso. Because it's boring. Perché è noioso. And talking about treno, I also want you to know the word station, stazione. Stazione. Prendo il treno almeno due volte al mese. Prendo il treno, I take the train, at least, almeno, due volte, twice, al mese, a month, dalla stazione di Milano, from Milano station. Prendo il treno, almeno due volte al mese, dalla stazione di Milano. I take the train at least twice a month from Milano station. Another verb that you actually have to know, even though I hope you don't need it, is perdere. I know that it literally means to lose, like you lost something, but it also means to miss, like you missed the train. Ho perso il treno. I missed the train. Perdere. Ho perso il pullman. Ho perso l'autobus. Pullman and autobus both mean bus. A che ora parte il pullman? What time does the bus leave? A che ora parte? What time does the bus leave? Parte. A che ora parte il pullman? Okay? While if I say è appena passato, it just passed, it means that, for example, when you're waiting at the stop, which by the way is not stazione, like for the train, but stop is fermata. So if you're waiting at the fermata and you want to know when the bus comes, when is the bus coming, you say a che ora passa il pullman? A che ora passa? what time does the bus come, as in passes? It passes through. Hopefully it will not just pass, it will stop at your stop. But yeah, we use the verb passare, to pass, passare. So now that you have all the verbs that you can use with means of transport, let's see some more of them, some more vocabulary, right? For example, taxi, it's easy. Per favore, chiama un taxi. Please call a taxi. Per favore, please, chiama, call a taxi. Chiama un taxi. Macchina, macchina, car. You could also say auto, auto, or automobile. In fact, auto is just a shorter version of automobile, but it's common to say macchina as well. Dov'è la mia macchina? Where's my car? I always ask that because I always forget where I put that at the parcheggio. Parcheggio. Parking, right? Then we have bici. Bici comes from bicicletta. Bicicletta, which is the bike. Vado in bici al parco. I go to the park by bike. Bici. While motorbike is moto. Moto. Because it is motocicletta, as in English. Motorbike, motocicletta, while bicicletta is just bici. If you don't have a proper motorbike, then maybe you have a scooter. Scooter. Or motorino. Motorino. A small motorbike, basically. It's cute. Motorino. Motorino. Maybe you're traveling by boat. Barca. Barca. Sto male sulla barca. I feel sick on a boat. Sto male, not well, sick. Su una barca. Sulla barca. On the boat. On a boat. Barca. Barca. Or maybe you have a van. Furgone. Furgone. Sul furgone possono stare tre persone. Three people can ride a van. Sul furgone possono stare tre persone. Now, it is not actually a mean of transport, but what you need to know is how to say by foot, on foot, right? Of course, you can just say camminare, walk, mi piace camminare, I like to walk, or vado, for example, in ufficio, I go to the office, a piedi, by foot. On foot, a piedi. While for the rest of words you use con and the article, con la metropolitana, con la macchina, or you just say in, because you're inside that object, as in metropolitana, in macchina. With by foot, you can only say a piedi. You cannot say in piedi, because it means that you're standing. You cannot say con I piedi, with the foot, okay? That's the only one that doesn't require an article. A piedi, just the preposition. A piedi. Vado a fare la spesa. I go groceries. Vado a fare la spesa a piedi. By foot, by walking. Vuoi un passaggio? Do you want a ride, a lift? Passaggio? No, grazie. No, thank you. Voglio camminare. I want to walk. Voglio camminare. Sì, volentieri. Yes, please. Gladly. Sì, volentieri. Volentieri. That being said, qual è il vostro mezzo di trasporto preferito? Which is your favorite mean of transport? Qual è il vostro mezzo di trasporto preferito? Io direi, I would say, io direi la macchina, the car, if I don't have to drive. Se non guido io. If I'm not driving myself. Se, if, non guido io. If I'm not driving. I'm the laziest one, I know. Thank you for watching. Remember to like and subscribe if you haven't. And if you want to learn even more Italian, just click the link in the description, download our PDF lessons, and learn essential phrases for your everyday life. I'll see you soon. Ci vediamo presto. Bye bye. Ciao ciao. Hello everyone, welcome back to ItalianPod101.com. My name is Daisy. Mi chiamo Daisy. Mi chiamo Daisy. And in this video we're gonna talk about ifs. Se. Periodo ipotetico. Periodo ipotetico. Se. Se. As in English, in Italian as well, this pattern is made by two parts, a sentence and a consequence, right? Easily said, if you go to the supermarket, could you buy me some milk? Se vai al supermercato, puoi comprarmi del latte? Se vai, if you go, al supermercato, to the supermarket, puoi comprarmi del latte? Could you buy me some milk? So till here, everything may seem simple, but the problem is that we have three types of periodo ipotetico, so hypothetical phrases. Some may also say four, because then you can mix them, but let's say three for now and let's check them together. Il periodo ipotetico zero, so the hypothetical phrase zero, is the most simple one, and in this case you can think of if, of se, as in when. So when this happens, then that happens as well. For example, se mangi troppo, ingrassi. If you eat too much, se mangi troppo, present tense, ingrassi. You will get fat, you get fat, present and present tense, easy. Se non studi tutti i giorni, if you don't study every day, se non studi tutti i giorni, è difficile imparare una lingua. It's hard to learn a language. È difficile imparare una lingua. And this is not even included in the three types, right? Because this is type zero. It's just present tense for both parts and it's linear. If this happens, then this also happens, right? And we're not even talking about possibilities there. It's just reality. A equals B. While when we talk about periodo ipotetico 1, periodo ipotetico 1, we're talking about a possibility that may come true if something else happens. It's not that it happens 100%, but it's most likely to happen. For example, se piove, non uscirò. If it rains, I won't go out. Se piove, non uscirò. If it rains, I won't go out. It's my choice, but I'm saying that if this happens, then I won't do that. I could do that, okay, because it's not impossible for me to do that. I decide not to do that. Se piove, non uscirò. Same goes for se non parti immediatamente, if you don't leave immediately, se non parti immediatamente, perderai il treno. You will miss the train. Perderai il treno. It's not 100% sure, but it's most likely to happen, right? And it's a real possibility. Se non parti subito, se non parti immediatamente, if you don't leave immediately, you will miss the train. Perderai il treno. Present and future. You could also use only future as well. Se otterrò quel lavoro, se otterrò quel lavoro, if I'll get that job, festeggeremo insieme al ristorante. We'll celebrate together at the restaurant. Se otterrò quel lavoro, festeggeremo insieme al ristorante. Future and future. Il periodo ipotetico 2 talks about something that it's not impossible in your life in general, but it's not possible at the moment. It's something that, based on facts, it's not a reality. It could be. It's a possibility. Se parlassi italiano, lavorerei in Italia. Se parlassi italiano, lavorerei in Italia. If I spoke Italian, I would work in Italy. Se parlassi is the nightmare tense of Italian, okay? It's what everyone finds the most difficult. Subjunctive. Subjunctive. Il congiuntivo. Se parlassi italiano, lavorerei in Italia. If I spoke Italian, I would work in Italy. Lavorerei is just conditional, condizionale. So here the problem is that you have to study il congiuntivo and then use it. There is no other way around it. You have to study il congiuntivo, subjunctive. Okay? In case you've never heard of it, I'll just tell you the most used ones. So essere and avere. Essere, to be. Actually, il congiuntivo starts with che, and that's how you recognize it. But in this case, we're using if, so se. Se io fossi. Se io fossi. If I were. Se io fossi sportivo, giocherei a basket. If I were sporty, if I were a sport type of person, giocherei a basket. I would play basketball. Se io fossi. Se tu fossi, se lui fosse, se noi fossimo, se voi foste, se loro fossero. Ok? Same goes for avere, to have. Se io avessi tanti soldi, se io avessi tanti soldi, if I had a lot of money, girerei il mondo. Girerei il mondo. I'd go around the world. Girerei il mondo. Se io avessi tanti soldi. If I had a lot of money. Se tu avessi. Se lui avesse. Se noi avessimo. Se voi aveste. Se loro avessero. This is il congiuntivo. So, il periodo ipotetico numero 2 tells us that if this thing happened, then this would also happen. Se io avessi, farei. If I had, I'd do. The last one, il periodo ipotetico numero 3, tells us the same thing as type number 2, but in the past. So, it's something that can't be changed anymore, and it goes the same, so with subjunctive, congiuntivo, and conditional, condizionale, but in past tense. If this thing had happened, then this would also have happened or would be happening right now. Se avessi studiato di più, avrei passato l'esame. Se avessi studiato, the past. Avessi, congiuntivo of avere, studiato, past. Se avessi studiato di più, if I had studied more, se avessi studiato di più, avrei passato l'esame. I would have passed the exam. Avrei passato l'esame. Se fossi stato sportivo, using the same example as before, before it was, so type number 2 was, se fossi sportivo, giocherei a basket. If I were a sport kind of person, I would play basketball. Okay, it's not completely impossible, but it's not possible based on the facts that I have right now. Okay, type number 3 tells us that it's impossible. For example, maybe I'm saying this when I'm super old and I cannot play any sports anymore. I could say, se fossi stato sportivo, se fossi stato sportivo, so in the past. If I had been a sport kind of person, a sport type person, avrei giocato a basket. So not giocherei, conditional present, but avrei giocato in the past. Avrei giocato a basket. Se avessi avuto tanti soldi, if I had had a lot of money, not if I just had money, se avessi soldi, but se avessi avuto tanti soldi, avrei girato il mondo. I would have traveled the world. Or you could also say, se avessi avuto tanti soldi, if I had had a lot of money, now, adesso, starei girando il mondo. Right now, I would have been traveling around the world. Girando instead of girato. Avrei girato, starei girando. Since I told you what's the congiuntivo for essere and avere, I also want to tell you the past form. So, se fossi becomes se fossi stato or avuto. Se fossi stato, se avessi avuto. Se loro avessero avuto un bambino, if they had had a kid, se loro avessero avuto un bambino, avrebbero capito. They would have understood, avrebbero capito cosa dicevano i genitori, what the parents said. se loro avessero avuto un bambino, avrebbero capito. Type number 3, while type number 2 would be, try to think about it with me, se avessero un bambino, and that's it, because it's not in the past, it could still happen, se avessero un bambino, capirebbero cosa dicono i genitori. They would understand what the parents say. And that's it for rules. I know it's really hard, and believe me or not, a lot of Italians don't even know how to use that. Especially nowadays, a lot of people make a lot of mistakes. In particular, the most common one, which is the one that I want you to pay attention to, is that they use the past simple. Se avevo, instead of se avessi. Or se facessi, se facevo. Okay? Because it's easier, of course, but it's also very, very wrong. So my tip would be, of course, study il congiuntivo, study subjunctive, but if you don't remember it, or if you are not really sure, if you're confused, just keep it simple, okay? Use type 0 or type 1, and just know that il congiuntivo exists, so that when you hear that, you know what people are talking about. So you know that if they say avessero, and you may not know how to use this tense, you know that they're talking about something that didn't happen, and it's only an if phrase, okay? That's my tip. Just get used to listen to congiuntivo and understand when people are not talking about something real. Se avete domande, scrivete nei commenti. If you have questions, write in the comments. Also, if you haven't done it yet, remember to sign up for your free lifetime account on italianpod101.com. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you soon. Ciao, ciao. Bye-bye.
Welcome to Can Do Italian by italianpod101.com.
Ciao a tutti, sono Felice Angelini. Hi everyone, I am Felice Angelini. In this lesson, you learn how to introduce yourself in Italian.
This is Margalie, and he's on a plane to Italy. Paolo Parisi, a passenger sitting next to him, introduces himself by saying, "Hello, I'm Paolo Parisi. Nice to meet you."
Buongiorno, sono Paolo Parisi. Piacere.
Listen to the conversation and focus on Mark's response. Ready?
Buongiorno, sono Paolo Parisi. Piacere.
Piacere. Sono Mark Lee.
Once more, with the English translation.
Buongiorno, sono Paolo Parisi. Piacere.
Hello, I'm Paolo Parisi. Nice to meet you.
Piacere. Sono Mark Lee.
Nice to meet you. I'm Mark Lee.
Let's take a closer look at Mark's response.
Do you remember how Mark Lee introduces himself? Nice to meet you. I'm Mark Lee.
Piacere. Sono Mark Lee.
First is the expression
piacere,
meaning a pleasure.
Piacere. Piacere. Piacere.
Is actually a shortened version of
piacere di conoscerla,
meaning it's a pleasure to meet you.
Piacere di conoscerla.
Both Mark and Paolo use the short form
piacere
in their introductions. This shortened version can be used in many contexts and is appropriate for both formal and informal situations. Do you remember how Mark says, "I'm Mark Lee"?
Sono Mark Lee.
First is
sono.
I am.
Sono. Sono.
Note.
Sono.
Is a shortened form of
io sono.
In Italian,
io.
I is usually omitted as it can be understood from context.
Sono
is from the verb
Essere.
Meaning to be.
Essere.
Next is the name.
Mark Lee.
Mark Lee.
Mark Lee. Mark Lee.
Together, it's...
Sono Mark Lee.
I'm Mark Lee.
Sono Mark Lee.
The pattern is...
Sono. Name.
I'm name.
Sono. Name.
To use this pattern, simply replace the name placeholder with your name. Imagine you're Karen Lee. In Italian...
Karen Lee. Karen Lee. Karen Lee.
Say, I'm Karen Lee. Ready?
Sono Karen Lee.
I'm Karen Lee.
Sono Karen Lee.
Let's look at some more examples. Listen and repeat, or speak along with the native speakers.
Piacere, sono Paolo Parisi. Piacere, sono Paolo Parisi.
Piacere, sono Mark Lee. Piacere, sono Mark Lee.
Piacere, sono Karen Lee. Piacere, sono Karen Lee.
Piacere, sono Felice Angelini. Piacere, sono Felice Angelini.
Piacere, mi chiamo Rosa Romano. Piacere, mi chiamo Rosa Romano.
Did you notice how the last speaker uses a different pattern?
She says,
Mi chiamo Rosa Romano.
My name is Rosa Romano.
Mi chiamo Rosa Romano.
This pattern uses the phrase
Mi chiamo,
which literally means I myself call, but translates as my name is.
Mi chiamo. Mi chiamo.
First is
Mi.
Meaning, me.
Me. Me.
After this is...
Chiamo.
Meaning, I call.
Chiamo. Chiamo.
Note...
Chiamo.
Is the shortened form of...
Io chiamo.
In Italian...
Io.
I is usually omitted.
Chiamo.
Is from the verb
chiamare,
to call.
Chiamare.
Next is the name
Rosa Romano.
Rosa Romano.
Rosa Romano. Rosa Romano.
Altogether,
Mi chiamo Rosa Romano.
Literally, myself I call Rosa Romano. But it translates as, my name is Rosa Romano.
Mi chiamo Rosa Romano.
The pattern is,
Mi chiamo, name.
My name is, name.
Mi chiamo, name.
You should be aware of this pattern, but for this lesson, we'll use the pattern.
Sono, name.
I'm, name.
Sono, name.
Let's review the key vocabulary.
Buongiorno.
Hello.
Buongiorno. Buongiorno.
Let's review. Respond to the prompts by speaking aloud. Then repeat after me, focusing on pronunciation. Ready?
Do you remember how to say, nice to meet you?
Piacere. Piacere. And the Italian pronunciation of Mark Lee's name? Mark Lee. Mark Lee. Do you remember how Mark Lee says, I'm Mark Lee? Sono Mark Lee. Sono Mark Lee. And do you remember how Mark Lee says, nice to meet you, I'm Mark Lee?
Piacere, sono Mark Lee.
Piacere, sono Mark Lee. Do you remember how Paolo Parisi says, hello? Buongiorno. Buongiorno. Do you remember how Paolo Parisi says, hello, I'm Paolo Parisi. Nice to meet you.
Buongiorno, sono Paolo Parisi. Piacere.
Buongiorno, sono Paolo Parisi. Piacere.
Let's practice. Imagine you're Karen Lee.
Karen Lee.
Respond to Paolo Parisi's self-introduction. Ready?
Buongiorno, sono Paolo Parisi. Piacere.
Piacere, sono Karen Lee.
Listen again and repeat.
Piacere, sono Karen Lee. Piacere, sono Karen Lee.
Let's try another. Imagine you're Rosa Romano.
Rosa Romano.
Ready?
Buongiorno, sono Paolo Parisi. Piacere.
Piacere, sono Rosa Romano.
Listen again and repeat.
Piacere, sono Rosa Romano. Piacere, sono Rosa Romano.
Let's try one more. Imagine you're Felice Angelini.
Felice Angelini.
Ready?
Buongiorno, sono Paolo Parisi. Piacere.
Piacere, sono Felice Angelini.
Listen again and repeat.
Piacere, sono Felice Angelini. Piacere, sono Felice Angelini.
In casual situations, you can also use this pattern with just your first name. For example, in the case of Karen Lee, you can simply say, sono Karen. I'm Karen. Sono Karen. This is the end of this lesson.
Remember, these can-do lessons are about learning practical language skills. What's next? Show us what you can do. When you're ready, take your assessment. You can take it again and again, so try anytime you like. Our teachers will assess it and give you your results.
Well done! Now you know how to introduce yourself in Italian. That's all there is to it. Keep practicing and move on to the next lesson.
Welcome to Can Do Italian by ItalianPod101.com.
Ciao a tutti, sono Felice Angelini. Hi everyone, I'm Felice Angelini. In this lesson, you learn how to tell someone where are you from in Italian.
This is Mark Lee, and he's on a plane to Italy. Paolo Parisi, a passenger sitting next to him, asks, "Where are you from?"
Di dov'è?
Listen to the conversation and focus on Mark's response. Note the speakers in this conversation use formal Italian. Ready?
Di dov'è?
Sono di New York.
Once more with the English translation.
Di dov'è?
Where are you from?
Sono di New York.
I am from New York.
Let's take a closer look at the conversation.
Do you remember how Paolo Parisi asks, "Where are you from?"
Di dov'è?
First is
di,
meaning from in this context.
Di. Di.
Next is
dov'è?
A formal phrase which translates as where are you?
Dov'è?
First is
dove?
Where?
Dove? Dove?
Next is
è.
You are when using formal Italian.
È. È.
Note
è
is a shortened form of
lei è.
You are. In Italian,
lei.
You, when using formal Italian, can be omitted when it is understood from context.
È
is from the verb
essere,
meaning to be.
Essere. Dove
is contracted with
è
to form
dov'è.
Altogether,
di dov'è?
Where are you from?
Di dov'è?
Remember this question. You'll hear it again later in this lesson.
Now, let's take a closer look at the response.
Do you remember how Mark Lee says, "I am from New York"?
Sono di New York.
First is
sono.
I am.
Sono. Sono.
Note in this sentence
sono
is a shortened form of
io sono.
I am. In Italian,
io.
I is usually omitted as it's understood from context.
Sono
is from the verb
essere,
meaning to be.
Essere.
Next is
di,
from in this context.
Di.
Last is the city.
New York.
New York.
New York. New York.
Altogether,
sono di New York.
I am from New York.
Sono di New York.
The pattern is
sono di city name.
I am from city name.
Sono di city name.
Note this pattern works only with the names of cities, villages, or towns. To use this pattern, simply replace the city name placeholder with the name of your hometown city. Imagine you're from Sydney. In Italian,
Sydney. Sydney. Sydney.
Say, I am from Sydney. Ready?
Sono di Sydney.
I am from Sydney.
Sono di Sydney.
Let's look at some examples. Listen and repeat, or speak along with the native speakers.
Sono di New York. Sono di New York.
Sono di Bologna. Sono di Bologna.
Sono di Seattle. Sono di Seattle.
Sono di Londra. Sono di Londra.
Sono di Roma. Sono di Roma.
Sono australiana. Sono australiana.
Did you notice how the last speaker uses a different pattern?
Sono australiana.
I am Australian.
Sono australiana.
Instead of
di
plus the city name placeholder, she uses an adjective for her nationality. This pattern is
sono nationality.
I am nationality.
Sono nationality.
In Mia Martin's case, she uses a feminine adjective
australiana
to describe herself.
Sono australiana.
In the case of a male speaker from Australia, he would use a masculine adjective
australiano
to describe himself.
Sono australiano.
I'm Australian.
Sono australiano.
You can use this response to answer the question
di dov'è?
You should be aware of this pattern, but for this lesson, we'll use the pattern
sono di city name.
I am from city name.
Sono di city name.
Let's review the key vocabulary.
Bologna.
Bologna.
Bologna. Bologna. Seattle.
Seattle.
Seattle. Seattle. Londra.
London.
Londra. Londra. Roma.
Rome.
Roma. Roma.
Let's review. Respond to the prompts by speaking aloud. Then repeat after me, focusing on pronunciation. Ready? Do you remember how to say New York? New York. New York. And how to say from? Di. Di. Do you remember how Mark says, I am from New York? Sono di New York. Sono di New York. Do you remember the formal way to say, where are you? Dov'è? Dov'è? And do you remember how Paolo Parisi asks, where are you from? Di dov'è? Di dov'è? Do you remember how to say London? Londra. Londra. And how to say Seattle? Seattle. Seattle. Do you remember how to say Rome? Roma. Roma.
Let's practice. Imagine you're Jack Jones from London. Respond to Paolo Parisi's question. Ready?
Di dov'è? Sono di Londra.
Listen again and repeat.
Sono di Londra. Sono di Londra.
Let's try another. Imagine you're Emma Esposito from Seattle. Ready?
Di dov'è?
Sono di Seattle.
Listen again and repeat.
Sono di Seattle. Sono di Seattle.
Let's try one more. Imagine you're Felice Angelini from Rome. Ready?
Di dov'è?
Sono di Roma.
Listen again and repeat.
Sono di Roma. Sono di Roma.
This is the end of this lesson.
Remember, these can-do lessons are about learning practical language skills. What's next? Show us what you can do. When you're ready, take your assessment. You can take it again and again, so try anytime you like. Our teachers will assess it and give you your results.
Well done. Now you know how to talk about where you're from in Italian. That's all there is to it. Keep practicing and move on to the next lesson.
This is Mark Lee, and he's on a plane to Italy. He asks the passenger sitting next to him, Paolo Parisi, "Are you a student?"
È studente?
Listen to the conversation and focus on Paolo's response. Note, the speakers in this conversation use formal Italian. Ready?
È studente?
No, non sono studente. Sono investitore.
Once more with the English translation.
È studente?
Are you a student?
No, non sono studente. Sono investitore.
No, I'm not a student. I'm an investor.
Let's take a closer look at the conversation.
Do you remember how Mark asks, "Are you a student?"
È studente?
First is
è.
You are when using formal Italian.
È. È.
Note
è
is a shortened form of
lei è.
You are in Italian.
Lei.
You, when using formal Italian, can be omitted when it is understood from context.
È
is from the verb
essere.
Meaning, to be.
Essere.
Next is
studente.
Student.
Studente. Studente.
In Italian, all nouns have grammatical gender and are either singular or plural.
Studente
is masculine singular. Altogether.
È studente?
Are you a student?
È studente?
Now, let's take a closer look at the response.
Do you remember how Paolo says, "No, I'm not a student. I'm an investor."
No, non sono studente. Sono investitore.
First is the expression
no,
meaning no.
No. No.
It answers Mark's yes or no question, are you a student?
È studente.
After this, Paolo specifies that he's not a student.
Non sono studente.
I'm not a student.
Non sono studente.
First is
non.
Not.
Non. Non.
Next is
sono.
I am.
Sono. Sono.
Note here
sono
is a shortened form of
io sono.
I am. In Italian,
io.
I is usually omitted as it's understood from context.
Sono
is from the verb
essere,
meaning to be.
Essere.
Together, it's
non sono.
Literally, not I am, but it translates as I'm not.
Non sono.
Next is
studente.
Student.
Studente.
Altogether,
non sono studente.
I'm not a student.
Non sono studente.
Paolo then tells Mark his actual occupation.
Sono investitore.
I'm an investor.
Sono investitore.
First,
sono.
I am.
Sono.
Next is
investitore.
Investor.
Investitore. Investitore.
The word
investitore
is masculine singular. Together,
sono investitore.
I'm an investor.
Sono investitore.
Altogether,
no, non sono studente, sono investitore.
No, I'm not a student. I'm an investor.
No, non sono studente. Sono investitore.
The pattern is
no, non sono
occupation.
Sono
actual occupation. No, I'm not occupation. I'm actual occupation.
No, non sono
occupation.
Sono
actual occupation. Imagine you're Emma Esposito, a student. The word for a female student is
studentessa. Studentessa. Studentessa.
Paolo Parisi asks you if you're a teacher.
Insegnante. Insegnante. Insegnante.
Say, no, I'm not a teacher. I'm a student. Ready?
No, non sono insegnante. Sono studentessa.
No, I'm not a teacher. I'm a student.
No, non sono insegnante. Sono studentessa.
In Italian, some occupations have the same word for both genders. For example,
insegnante. Insegnante. Insegnante.
However, much of the time, words will differ depending on gender. In general, nouns that end in O tend to be masculine, while nouns that end in A tend to be feminine. Let's look at some more examples. Listen and repeat, or speak along with the native speakers.
No, non sono studente. Sono investitore. No, non sono studente. Sono investitore.
No, non sono insegnante. Sono studentessa. No, non sono insegnante. Sono studentessa.
No, non sono insegnante. Sono ingegnere. No, non sono insegnante. Sono ingegnere.
No, non sono infermiera. Sono medico. No, non sono infermiera. Sono medico.
No, non sono studente. Sono insegnante. No, non sono studente. Sono insegnante.
No, sono barista. No, sono barista.
Did you notice how the last speaker omits part of the response?
No, sono barista.
No, I'm a barista.
No, sono barista.
When directly responding to someone's question, it's often possible to omit part of the response. Here, by simply answering
no.
No, there's no need to say
non sono studentessa.
I'm not a student. This pattern is
no, sono
actual occupation. No, I'm actual occupation.
No, sono
actual occupation. You should be aware of this, but for this lesson, we'll use the pattern
no, non sono
occupation.
Sono
actual occupation. No, I'm not occupation. I'm actual occupation.
No, non sono
occupation.
Sono
actual occupation. Let's review the key vocabulary. Student.
Studente. Studente. Studentessa. Studentessa. Insegnante.
Teacher.
Insegnante. Insegnante. Ingegnere.
Engineer.
Ingegnere. Ingegnere.
Nurse.
Infermiere. Infermiere. Infermiera. Infermiera. Medico.
Doctor.
Medico. Medico. Barista.
Barista.
Barista. Barista.
Let's review. Respond to the prompts by speaking aloud. Then repeat after me, focusing on pronunciation. Ready? Do you remember how Paolo says investor? Investitore. Investitore. And how Paolo says I'm an investor? Sono investitore. Sono investitore. Do you remember how Paolo says student? Studente. Studente. And how to say not? Non. Non. You remember how Paolo says, I am not a student. Non sono studente. Non sono studente. Do you remember how Paolo Parisi says, I'm not a student, I'm an investor?
Non sono studente, sono investitore.
Non sono studente, sono investitore. Do you remember how Mark Lee asks, are you a student? Remember, Mark uses formal Italian.
È studente?
È studente? Do you remember the word for a female student? Studentessa. Studentessa. And the word for teacher. Insegnante. Insegnante. Do you remember the word for engineer? Ingegnere. Ingegnere.
Let's practice. Imagine you're Mark Lee and you're an engineer. Respond to Paolo's question. Ready?
È insegnante?
No, non sono insegnante, sono ingegnere.
Listen again and repeat.
No, non sono insegnante, sono ingegnere. No, non sono insegnante, sono ingegnere.
Let's try another. Imagine you're Felice Angelini and you're a teacher. Ready?
È studente?
No, non sono studente, sono insegnante.
Listen again and repeat.
No, non sono studente, sono insegnante. No, non sono studente, sono insegnante.
Let's try one more. Now imagine you're Emma Esposito and you're a student. Ready?
È insegnante.
No, non sono insegnante, sono studentessa.
Listen again and repeat.
No, non sono insegnante, sono studentessa. No, non sono insegnante, sono studentessa.
This is the end of this lesson.
Remember, these can-do lessons are about learning practical language skills. What's next? Show us what you can do. When you're ready, take your assessment. You can take it again and again, so try anytime you like. Our teachers will assess it and give you your results.
Well done. Now you know how to talk about your occupation in Italian. That's all there is to it. Keep practicing and move on to the next lesson.
Hey everyone, welcome to the Monthly Review, the monthly show on language learning, where you discover new learning strategies, motivational tips, study tools, and resources. By the way, all the lessons and bonuses you're about to see can be downloaded for free on our website. So click the link in the description right now to sign up for your free lifetime account. Okay, today's topic is the first step in your language learning journey that will guarantee your success. If you have trouble sticking with your language learning goals, it's probably because you're skipping one specific step. It's the step you need to take before you even start any learning. And doing it will help you stick with the language, not get overwhelmed, and reach your language goals. So, today you'll learn 1. What solo language learners need to succeed, and 2. How to do self-assessment and set yourself up for success. But first, listen up. Here are this month's new lessons and resources. Be sure to download these now before we take them down in a few days. First, the Giving Directions Conversation Cheat Sheet. Do you know how to tell a taxi driver where to go in your target language? You'll be able to. With this PDF cheat sheet, you'll learn must-know words and phrases for giving directions. Second, the Most Common Verbs PDF eBook. You'll learn over 90 common verbs with this bonus PDF picture eBook. Download and review on any device. Third, how to talk about what you do in your free time. Learn how to say video games, fishing, and much more. You'll pick up over 25 words for leisure activities with this vocab bonus. Fourth, how to learn from home, learning strategies. Want to learn the language from the comfort of your home? This 1-minute lesson will give you all the best tactics for learning languages. Fifth, the top 35 adjectives for personalities. Can you describe your personality? This next bonus teaches you the 35 must-know adjectives for personalities, so you can talk about yourself in your target language. To get your free resources, click the link in the description below right now. They're yours to keep forever. Okay, let's jump into today's topic. The first step in your language learning journey that will guarantee your success. Here's a question for you. When you want to learn a language, how do you usually get started with that goal? You might say the inspiration comes first, and that motivates you to start. Then you get a textbook or an app and go from there, right? That's a pretty standard answer, but how does that tend to work out? Most people end up falling off a week or a month later. Why do you think that happens? Leave a comment with why you think people tend to lose inspiration quickly. More often than not, it happens because you pick a goal, a learning routine, or a resource that overwhelms you and just isn't right for you. Here's a typical example. Let's say you work an 8-hour day and you want to try to start learning. Most people would try to squeeze in learning for 1 or 2 hours at night, or you could try and wake up an hour early. And usually that doesn't work out because you're trying to do things that you're not used to. Wake up earlier and study earlier. It doesn't fit your current lifestyle. So what should you do differently? Well, let's take an example from language schools. Before you start learning, language schools force you to take an assessment test on the first day. Why? So that they make sure the language lessons fit your level and put you in the proper class. The goal of an assessment test is to find out where you are and meet you there. That's something most solo learners don't do. And the problem is, if you're a solo learner, no one assesses you, and you yourself don't know what routine works best for you, how much time you can set aside, and how much studying you can comfortably do. We all imagine we can do an hour a day, but realistically speaking, it'll be a lot less than that. So, that's where self-assessment comes in. Before you start learning a language, or do any goal for that matter, it's important to know where you are in life, what your daily schedule is like, when you're busy and when you're free. So you can set your expectations, know how much time you can put in, and so you can start learning at a pace that works for you. Now, how do you actually assess yourself? There are 3 assessments you can do. 1, a life assessment. 2, a routine assessment. And 3, language assessment. Language assessment will only be helpful if you already have some experience. If you're brand new, you won't need this. First, life assessment. Here, the goal is to see how the language will fit into your life and how you generally deal with goals. As in, if you succeeded with a goal before, what helped you succeed? You could take that and apply it here. If you failed before, find out why so you can avoid it this time. So you'll need to answer the following questions. Why are you learning this language? How will it help your life? What current connections do you have to this language? For example, listening to music, watching TV, you have a relative, you have neighbors or friends that speak it. What have you been doing so far to learn? Have you learned languages before? Have you failed any goals before? How or why? Have you succeeded with any goals before? How or why? Write these questions out and answer them. Next, the routine assessment. Write out your daily routine for a whole week. For example, wake up at 7 a.m., breakfast at 8 a.m., commute to work at 8:30 a.m., arrive at work at 9:30 a.m., lunch at 1 p.m., and so on. Do this for every day of the week. The goal here is to see what your daily routine is like, so you know when you're free, when you're busy, and where you can fit in language learning. That way, if you're super busy on Mondays and 5 minutes is all you can do, then that's good enough. You won't feel bad about doing only 5 minutes. If you see that you spend 30 minutes on commuting, add language learning on top of that existing routine. If you take walks or go for a jog, play an audio lesson there. Or even if you're cooking at a certain time, play an audio lesson in the background. Remember, look for an existing routine that you already stick with, like commuting, and where you can multitask. Don't try to create new routines. For example, waking up at 7 a.m. to learn will set you up for failure. If you usually wake up at 8 a.m., waking up at 7 a.m. will be even harder. And then, actually trying to learn a language at 7 a.m. makes it even harder. This is where new learners start having trouble. You're trying to do two things at once, trying to learn the language and trying to stick to a new routine. One is hard enough. Trying to do two can overwhelm you. So piggyback off of your existing routines first, so you can build momentum. And finally, there's language assessment. If you're an absolute beginner, you won't need much of an assessment. Just start with our absolute beginner recommended learning pathway. But if you have experience and want to assess yourself, there are two things you can do. First, if you're a Premium Plus user, then you're asked to do an assessment test when you join, but you can always request it again from your teacher. And second, if you're a Premium user, check our recommended pathways. We assign these pathways, level 1 to level 5, based on your learning level, from absolute beginner to advanced. At the start of each pathway, there's a diagnostic test. You can take that to assess yourself. So thank you for watching this episode of Monthly Review. Next time, we'll talk about when routines grow stale, how to learn more language with a new routine. If you enjoyed these tips, hit the like button, share the video with anyone who's trying to learn a language, and subscribe to our channel. We release new videos every week. And if you're ready to finally learn language the fast, fun, and easy way and start speaking from your very first lesson, get our complete learning program. Sign up for your free lifetime account right now. Click the link in the description. See you next time. Bye. What's your reason for learning language? Is it a personal goal, a hobby, or do you have dreams of moving to a country where it's spoken? In this video, you'll learn why your reason is crucial for motivation and for your success in language learning. We'll look at the top 10 reasons for learning a language from language learners just like you. What's your number one reason for learning a language? Whatever your reason is, whether big or small, knowing it or knowing your why is crucial for success and motivation. Number one, I love the culture and the people who speak the language. This is a popular answer. Learning a language can be a great way to learn more about the culture and open up new ways to experience it. Number two, I want to understand my favorite songs, movies, and TV shows. That's right. Songs, movies, and shows are great ways to immerse yourself in the language. If you're spending your time learning and also immersing yourself, you'll learn faster. Number three, it's a beautiful language. Sometimes the answer is as simple as that. You have a genuine interest in the language itself. Number four, my family comes from a place where the language is spoken. This can be popular for students who have moved to a new country and might want to connect to their home country's culture. Learning a language lets them learn things about their heritage and communicate with people who can teach them more about their cultural history. If your grandmother speaks a different language from you, it can be pretty hard to connect. So a lot of people want to learn a language to connect to family members as well. Number five, I want to speak to my partner's family in their language. Similar to the reason above, perhaps you want to speak to your partner's parents or grandparents, but they don't speak your language. Not only can learning their native language let you connect with them on a more personal level, but it's also likely to impress them. Number six, I'm learning the language to impress someone. We have many students say that they want to learn a new language to impress someone in their life. This could be a teacher, a parent, a friend, or even someone they admire and look up to. It always feels good to accomplish something and have other people recognize and be proud of your achievement. And you see this very often in language learning. When you learn a new phrase or can make a longer conversation, the people around you are bound to be impressed. Number 7, a love of traveling. There's no surprise here. Many people want to learn a new language to be able to travel more. Because you can see new places and learn about different cultures, traveling is a popular hobby for many people. And what better way to connect with the people that you meet on your travels than by being able to speak with them in their native language? We have a lot of students who just want to learn some basic conversations to help them on their trips, but even this can help you day to day. Number 8, I want to live in a country that speaks the language. After traveling around, someone might discover a country that really appeals to them, and they might decide they want to move there. But their language skills could use some work. Or maybe for a job or family reason, someone has to move to a new country. Not knowing the language can really make adjusting to a new home, and even a new culture, much more difficult. We have a lot of students who want to learn a language to help them when they move. Number 9, I just love learning languages. This is popular for people whose hobby is learning other languages. They fall in love with the process of actually studying and being able to speak in a new language. It's a huge feeling of accomplishment. Number 10, I want to open my mind and become more international. It's so important to expand your horizons and learn about more than your own culture. People around the world live their lives in different ways, and it's good to learn about them and how they interact. You never know what you could learn by opening your ears and mind to new things. Whatever your reason might be for learning a new language, as long as it keeps you motivated, it's a good one. Learning a new language is not an easy journey. It's one filled with lots of ups and downs. So keep in mind your reason and motivation for learning, whether it's so you can move to a new country or connect with a grandparent, and let it push you towards success. And if you're ready to achieve your language goals, just check out our complete language learning program. Sign up for your free lifetime account by clicking on the link in the description. Get tons of resources to have you speaking in your target language. And if you enjoyed these tips, hit the like button, share the video with anyone who's trying to learn a new language, and subscribe to our channel. We release new videos every week. I'll see you next time. Bye! Want to know how to improve your listening and speaking skills, be able to save conversations, listen to them as many times as you want, and learn hundreds of practical everyday conversations? Well, there is an easy way to do this. In this video, we'll go over how to speak more using the dialogue track. So, what is the dialogue track? The dialogue track is an audio track with just the conversation from the lesson. It's only about 10 to 30 seconds long. Let's say you're looking at a 5-minute lesson about ordering food at a restaurant. First, you hear a conversation. Then our teachers explain every grammar rule and translate every word, so you know what it all means. That's where the dialogue track comes in. It gives you just the conversation. Here's what makes the dialogue track so powerful. First, you can quickly review the conversation without re-listening to the lesson. The dialogue track is just 10 to 30 seconds long, so it won't take you very long to cover both new and old information. This makes it perfect for a quick review of what you've just learned, and it helps keep it fresh in your brain. Second, you'll remember the conversations easier. Listen on repeat, like you would with a song, and the words, phrases, and grammar rules will stick better. And the more you come back to re-listen, the better it will all stick. Third, you'll speak more of your target language. So if you have 10, 20, or 100 dialogue tracks like that, then you have 10, 20, or 100 conversations that you'll know inside out and that you can use in real life. For example, conversations like catching up with friends, ordering at a restaurant, talking about your family, introducing yourself, and much, much more. Fourth, you improve your listening skills and can immerse yourself in the language. So imagine you've finished 20 lessons and you've downloaded 20 dialogue tracks to your phone. That's 20 conversations. You can create a playlist and play those 20 tracks and get used to the language and immerse yourself. To recap what we just learned, here's what you do to make the most of the dialogue tracks. First, after you finish a lesson, download the dialogue track. Save it to your computer or phone so you can listen to it on repeat whenever possible. Just replace 3 to 15 minutes of music listening for some language review. Next, if you've finished 20 lessons, you should have 20 dialogue tracks. Use those to create a playlist of these dialogue tracks so that you can listen to all kinds of conversations. And finally, try shadowing the conversations that you hear. This will become super easy once you've heard the conversation enough times. But if you're still struggling with a word or two, go back to the lesson and check the line-by-line breakdown of the conversation to find the words you need to practice. Boost your speaking skills with the dialogue track and check out our complete language learning program. Sign up for your free lifetime account by clicking on the link in the description. Get tons of resources to have you speaking in your target language. And if you enjoyed these tips, hit the like button, share the video with anyone who's trying to learn a new language, and subscribe to our channel. We release new videos every week. I'll see you next time. Bye! Want to power up your language? You can do this by using practical lessons that you can use in everyday life. In this video, you'll find out what it takes to power up your language right now. Imagine you're speaking a language without stopping to think. You have all the words and grammar to express what you want to say, and they're all flowing out of you as if you were a native speaker. That's when language becomes powerful. So how do you power up your language skills like that? Books and software alone won't help, but actual practical daily conversation lessons will. Native speakers that explain the conversation and teach you how to respond will power your language up, and so will these tools to help you master vocabulary and pronunciation quickly. First, power up your language with Premium. This includes hundreds of audio and video lessons that will get you speaking. And you should know that we publish new lessons weekly. So on top of the current lesson library, there are even more lessons that you can learn along the way. And whatever your learning level is, we start you off with a lesson that's right for you. You can track your progress and see how much you've mastered with our site dashboard. Seeing your progress really helps you power up your language skills. It's really motivating to know that you're actually speaking and understanding a language that you couldn't before. Next, use the lesson notes. You don't get just the lessons. You also get detailed notes with each and every lesson. Meaning you get the complete lesson in writing and can easily follow along while you study. Plus, we've just recently upgraded them. The notes are brand new, easier to read, and work on any device, browser, or reader. Last, we have our premium study tools. As a premium member, you have unlimited website access, which means you also unlock our premium study tools. You'll get access to our 2,000-word core vocabulary list. These words are the most commonly used in everyday conversation, and they're essential to your conversational fluency. And you'll master them fast with our smart flashcard system and the word bank. You can perfect your pronunciation by reading from line-by-line transcripts. This means you'll have access to all the must-know words, and you'll be able to practice them with the correct pronunciation. Don't let your language learning slow down. If you're running low on motivation, power up your language learning with Premium. Get all of our premium tools for studying. Just check out our complete language learning program. Sign up for your free lifetime account by clicking on the link in the description. Get tons of resources to have you speaking in your target language. And if you enjoyed these tips, hit the like button, share the video with anyone who's trying to learn a new language, and subscribe to our channel. We release new videos every week. I'll see you next time. Bye! Want to make consistent language breakthroughs? Here's how you do it with our advanced language learning system. In this video, you'll learn about four simple steps to make breakthroughs with our lessons. First, by breakthrough, we mean finally understanding and speaking language that you simply couldn't before. You finally break through. So if you're stuck at a beginner level or just aren't making much progress, this is for you. Here are four simple steps, but the first one is the most important one. Step one, accept that you need new lessons, new real-life conversations, new words, and new phrases. So you're hearing something new and improving your language skills. Repeating phrases you already know won't help you move forward. That's a mistake most learners make. They stick to what they already know. But if you could start understanding more language in minutes and start making consistent breakthroughs, would you? Well, here's how you break through with our learning system. Remember, you need to have a source of new lessons and new conversations to expose yourself to language you don't yet know. So if you're listening to our new lessons, which we publish weekly on top of our existing lesson library, you're good to go. If not, start right now. These lessons get you speaking and understanding language in minutes. Here's how. Visit the site, choose a new series or learning level that you haven't done already, and start with the first lesson. Step two, listen to a new lesson and expose yourself to real-life conversations. Now, you might not understand it at first, but in time you will. all the real-life conversations you hear in lessons are broken down, explained, and translated right after by our instructors. Plus, you can also read along with lesson notes so you never miss a word. So now you can actually understand the entire conversation. As a listener, you'll get exposed to brand new conversations and start understanding real-life conversations. So what's the next step? Step 3, you'll need to start speaking and repeating what you hear. That's the best way to start speaking any language. Do it from day one. With our voice recorder available inside the lessons, you can listen to each line of the conversation and then repeat and record yourself to see how close you are to a native speaker. Finally, step 4. In case you missed anything, you can review with vocab lists, quizzes, and the line-by-line feature. The line-by-line breaks down the conversation, so you can hear and read each line again and again. So even if you can't catch something the first time, you can review what you heard and be able to hear it on the next listen. But remember, the most important step is the first one. You must jump into new lessons and new conversations in order to make a language breakthrough. To make your language breakthrough, just check out our complete language learning program. Sign up for your free lifetime account by clicking on the link in the description. Get tons of resources to have you speaking in your target language. And if you enjoyed these tips, hit the like button, share the video with anyone who's trying to learn a new language, and subscribe to our channel. We release new videos every week. I'll see you next time. Bye. Great work. Here's a reward. Speed up your language learning with our PDF lessons. Get all of our best PDF cheat sheets and ebooks for free. Just click the link in the description.